Hi students, so in this video I shall be discussing the solutions of CM1 paper A which had come in April 2021 attempt. So the first question was pretty much straightforward, 4 marks. We were asked to calculate 3q 45 45 1 using AM92 mortality and assuming that both lives are independent with respect to its mortality. So here's a brief look at the solution. First, we need to split it into 3p 45 45 into 5q 48 48 with a 1 over 48. Now this is a joint life probability which can be split down into 3p 45 into 3p 45. And then since both of the age are equal and both of the mortalities are equal, we can write this as half into 5q 48 48. In the next step, what we do is we split 5q 48 48 into 1 minus 5p 48 48. And we know that npxy is nothing but npx into npy. Now taking the values from actuarial tables, we basically get the answer of 0.012451. This figure has been quoted till 6 decimal places. Next, we had question 2, which again, some of the students might have found this question a bit tricky, although it is almost on similar lines, which has been asked in previous sessions as well. Even in the September 2020 session, there was a similar question with respect to multiple decrement model, where a similar structure of question had come, wherein the integral expression had been given. All we had to do was basically find the numerical values of these parameters. So the key criteria is that under these policy, a lump sum benefit is payable when a life becomes critically ill during the term policy. No other benefits are payable. So you heard the only benefit is when the person becomes sick. The current age of the person is 35. It's a 30-year policy and the sum assured is of 1,50,000. Now it has been given that the EPV of the benefit at outset is given by this particular formula. And we need to state the numerical values of A, B, M, N, M, N, and Z. And in the part 2, we basically need to substitute these two, you know, calculate these values. So taking a look at the second solution, 1,50,000 is the sum assured, 0 to 30 is the limits, B to the power T, TP 35 HH bar, sigma 35 plus P DT. V to the power T is nothing but 1.03 to the power minus T. The question states that I is 3%. TP35HH bar, we basically know the formula for it. It shall be nothing but e to the power minus t into mu plus sigma. And since all the forces of transition are constant and independent of h, sigma 35 plus t can be simply substituted as sigma. In the next part, we substitute the values of sigma and mu. And again, one common mistake which could happen is, which even I attempted while solving it first time, is I kept it, I did not convert 1.03 to the power minus t in a form of e to the power something. Later I realized while putting down the values, what they have done in the question is that they have given m into a to b n into e to the power zt. So there should only term be e to the power, you know, zt. So that is how we need to basically bring our answer. We need to bring it to this particular form for part 1. So 1.03 to the power minus t can be written as e to the power minus t log 1.03. So the result which I have used is that x can be written as e to the power log x. And now we have basically expressed in their form where it comes out to be 1,50,000 into 0.02 into e to the power t, so on dt. Now there's a choice that a student can write 0.02 outside and 1,50,000 inside. But the more obvious logical thing would be to write in this particular format, whereas the sum assured or the benefit amount is basically written outside the integral. So these are the values of M, N, A, B, and Z. Substituting this, you will get basically EPV as 41,933.282. So you just need to, you know, integrate this, and doing that, you will be getting this particular answer. Moving to the next question, which is question number 3. It's again a pretty direct question. A fixed interest security of nominal amount 1 lakh was issued and it was redeemed at par. coupons were of 4% per annum annually in arrears, and then we have been given an inflation index. Part one asks us to demonstrate that the effective annual real rate of return achieved over the term of the security is approximately equal to minus 1.9% per annum. And part two was to comment on the results in part one. So firstly, what we need to do is we'll find basically the coupon amount. Once we find the coupon amount, which is pretty straightforward in this question, we need to do next is calculate the real values for same. So 1 lakh is equal to 4,000. This is basically the factor which we multiply to calculate the, you know, real value of this 4,000 as of today, and then 1 year discounting factor. Similarly, 2 year discounting factor. At the end of 3 years, there is 1 lakh of capital or principal being repaid, plus there's another 4,000 of the interest pending for the third year. So that makes a total of 1,04,000. Now, again, what you can do is, since they ask us to demonstrate that it is approximately minus 1.9%, you can simply substitute I as minus 0.019%, and RH will approximately come out to be 1 lakh itself. So this demonstrates that the real return is nothing but minus 1.9%. Now, making comments. So what we observe here is that, you know, the return, the real return which an investor is achieving is pretty less. It's actually negative. So this shows that inflation rate is too high. So one way to observe this is key within 1 year from 240, we're going to 256. So that's an increase of 16 on a base of 240, which I guess roughly turns out to be, you know, 6 to 7%. So when I say it is high with respect to the coupon amount which is being paid, which is of 4%. So that is one inference you could make. Inflation is higher than the coupon rate, thus we have negative real return. Another thing which, you know, you all should keep in mind is that India comparatively experiences a higher rate of inflation, although in these last few years it has substantially decreased. But before that, it was generally a country of high inflation rates. It's more of a property of, you know, most of the developing economies. As for developed economies, their inflation rates tend to be very low, and in certain countries it's negative. For example, in Japan, you will see actually deflation, that is negative inflation, where the prices can be seen to be decreasing year on year. So keeping that point in mind, an inflation rate of 6 to 7% is considered to be very high. So I'm just asking this because, you know, this question has been asked by IFOA. So in that part of the world, even an inflation of 2 to 3% might consider to be high given their economic circumstances. So here 6 to 7% becomes pretty high, although that might be pretty normal in India. Next is investor could look for, you know, alternative investments in index linked bond. So, you know, how to go about these comments is, first you'll identify ki what have you calculated in earlier parts. Just make a basic you know what to say, a reference to that. So here we see what you'll see is that we have a negative real return. So one point on that. Next thing could be on why. Why are we observing this? So here we are observing this because the inflation turns out to be more than the coupon rate. Next part could be key, you know, since it's 3 marks, it's an investment opportunity. So what other avenues could the investor invest in? So we could, the investor, you know, could to protect against inflation, the investor could look for, you know, index linked bonds, which will help it to mitigate the effects of inflation, since, you know, all cash flows would be dependent on the inflation rate itself. So this was question three. Again, quite a few of students, I'm pretty sure, must have skipped this part altogether, three part two. Question four, a pretty direct one, I would say. So we have been given the values of delta t. It's two different functions depending whether t is less than equal to 6 or greater than 6. And then correspondingly accumulation factor is there. So we need to find the values of a, b, c, f, g, and h. Now for examination point of view, obviously just fetching the values of a, b, c, f, g, and h should not fetch you full marks, because you're expected to derive the same. Right? I mean, it's not possible that without doing it, you might get the results. Again, IFA might give you full marks even if you haven't shown your workings. I'm not aware of that. That is something which the examiners will decide, given that, you know, so much of derivation might not be expected to be done on word. But as seen, you know, seeing other papers, gradually IFA is actually incorporating certain derivations in the papers itself, which they hadn't done in the previous session. So it would be, you know, going forward, unless there is some clear-cut communication from IFOA, it's better that you actually do these sort of workings on the MS Word script itself. So taking a look at the solution, not going through each step by step, that is something you all could maybe, you know, pause the video and take a look at it. The final values which we would be getting is A is 0, B is 0.03, C is 0.0025, F is minus 0.15, G is 0.1, and H comes out to be minus 0.005. As for part 2, calculate the annual nominal rate of return convertible monthly on the investment. 5,000 has been invested from 2 years for 5 years. So again, the thing to understand here is that this 5,000 is of no relevance. What we need to basically find is the equivalent annual nominal rate of return convertible monthly for the period 2 years to the period 7 years. It's at time 2 for 5 years. So basically the time involved is 2 and 7. So what first we need to do is find A27, which we can do it in the form of A07 divided by A02, because we have already derived something in the first part. We'll use the results from these. You could alternatively, you know, calculate A27 as A26 into A67. But again, that is something which will require more steps, and a more efficient way of doing this would be to use the result which we have already found in part one. We already know the value of A07. As in, we know the general form of A0T, both when T is greater than 6 as well as less than 6. And so once we substitute 7, and once on the other function we substitute 2, and on solving this, we basically get e to the power 0.235. Now this e to the power 0.235 should be equal to nothing but the 5 years accumulation factor, and the equivalent 5 year accumulation factor would be 1 plus I 12 by 12 whole to the power 12. This basically becomes 1 plus I and then another into 5. So that it becomes 1 plus I to the power 5. Solving this, you would be getting the value of I12, which comes out to be 4.71%. So again, a pretty, I would say, straightforward question. Next, what we have, question 5, which probably few students would have struggled to do, or they might have, you know, done it in a slightly different way, leading to the same possible answer. So I'll just share the solution with you. The key criteria here is to read the question, which says that the force of mortality mu star x experienced by a particular population at all ages x, at all ages x, where x is not necessarily an integer, is 20% higher than under the PMA 92C20 table. So the key thing to understand is, in actuarial tables, we are given values of mu x only at integer ages, and those are exact values, right? So you all might think, why not let's assume a constant force of mortality for throughout the year, take 20% higher than, and then work around it. Although here that is working because it's a flat 20% increase for all the ages, but a more technical way would be, we won't assume that the force, you know, the forces of transition, or should I say, the force of mortality is constant. Rather, whatever it is, whatever is the true rate, the new rate will be 20% higher than that. And then we'll solve it. I tried it using both the methods, using the method which a lot of students might have, you know, used, because I was going through certain answer scripts of my students where they had actually done this. It was leading to an almost similar answer. But again, that is something which is not the best way to, you know, do this question. So what we'll do is, mu star x is nothing but 1.2 times mu x, where mu x is the corresponding rate of PMA 92C20, which we do not have to take from the tables at all. Okay. So now we know that TPX is nothing but exponential integral mu x plus s ds 0 to t. I am taking TPX star, and therefore here correspondingly we have mu x star. Next, what I do is I replace mu star x plus s by 1.2 mu x plus s. Now, think in this way, this is exponential term. This 1.2 is, let's say, a, it's a constant, can be taken outside the integral. And then this another integral term is b. So what we have is e to the power ab, which can also be written as e to the power a whole to the power b. So exponential integral, this term, whole thing to the power 1.2. Now this term within the brackets is nothing but tpx itself. That is using the mortality rates of PMA 92 C20. So this is my underlying equation, TPX star equal to TPX whole to the power 1.2, which again you would have got had you assumed mu to be constant, would lead to the same result. But yes, this is a more correct way of doing this question. So we know that TQX is nothing but 1 minus TPX. So from here we get the relation between TQX star and TPX. And similarly, we can get a relation between, you know, QX star and QX, because ultimately from tables, we need to select the values of QX that will lead to a more efficient calculation. So see, what we have done is QX star, here it is TQX, here we are substituting T as 1. So QX star is 1 minus 1PX whole to the power 1.2. And 1PX can be written as 1 minus QX. Now we'll calculate 1PX star and 2PX star in this way. We get the numerical values where x is nothing but 70, since that is what we need to do. And then ADU 70 30 is nothing but 1 plus V 1P 70 star plus V square 2P 70 star. We substitute the values of 1P 70 star and 2P 70 star to get the result 2.76223816. For part 2, we had to calculate endowment assurance. And we know the relation between both an endowment assurance as well as a temporary annuity, which is payable in advance. So A7030 can be written as 1 minus DADU7030. Substituting these values, we get it as 0.819293148. So many of you might have struggled initially with this, or you know, might have solved this using slightly assuming forces of transition or force of mortality to be constant, and would probably be getting somewhere similar answers. Now, whether those fetch full marks or not is to be seen. You know, the examiners of IFA will, you know, just maybe see the answer scripts, or the examiners might take a call ki, whether they should be rewarding full marks in case students have assumed constant forces of transition. If you want to ask my suggestion, I feel they might end up giving full marks for same, because it has been seen that whenever a lot of students make a common mistake in a particular question, so they kind of sometimes end up giving, you know, full marks for it. Although here they should at least deduct some marks, let's say half or at least one, because the, you know, the well-prepared students or the students who got this right in the right way should deserve, you know, some more marks compared to others. So the only way out is to, you know, maybe deduct half or one mark to the ones who use a slightly incorrect technical method, although which led to the same answer. Next, we have question 6 again. What I understood was ki most of the students ignored the part 2. So a major reason for this is the reluctance of students to understand the concept of random variable. Especially a lot of students who maybe haven't studied CS1 before CM1 and are not very much comfortable with concept of random variable. For them, this might become more of an issue. But even, you know, the ones who I have actually studied, I was actually very disappointed to see answer scripts of few of the students who simply chose to, you know, skip this part. And their reason was, they were short on time, but then while seeing the question, they choose to simply skip it. And even after the end of the examination, they were not really sure how to go about this question. So that was something which was very disappointing for me, because this was an extremely straightforward question. Would have taken substantial time, you know, to perform calculations, but otherwise it was a direct question. So we are getting 40,000 in the form of death benefit if death happens in the first 15 years, and thereafter it becomes 50,000. So there are three ways to write EPV: first, second, third. And second is something which is kind of the most preferred route, because it will lead to the, you know, getting the answer in the most efficient technique. And the answer comes out to be 7669.77. As for calculating variance, whenever you have been asked to calculate variance, first thing which should hit your head is to, you know, write down the random variable. EPV can be written down intuitively without writing down present value, but the same thing cannot be done for, you know, variance. It could be done, but again, it requires you to process 3-4 steps in your head, which most of the students might not be able to do. So the best short technique is to write down the random variable. So before 15 years, it's 40,000, and after 15 years, it's 50,000. So to calculate variance, what I do is I do EPV square. So basically I'll have what, summation 0 to 14, 40,000 square, V to the power twice K plus 1 into probability KX equal to K. Or if I just ignore the second part, this is nothing but a term assurance. So 40,000 square, 2A 45, 50. And for the later part, it's nothing. If I ignore the first part, it looks in the form of nothing but a deferred whole life assurance. So I have 50,000 square deferred for 15 years to A60 again. The age is actually 45. So here, this should be actually 45 here, 2A45. The calculation seems to be done right itself. We have made the adjustment 60. This shall be actually 2A45. So now 40,000 square, 2A45, 15, we'll simply express it as whole minus deferred whole life. And then this will be 50,000 square. 15 deferred 2A45 is nothing but V to the power 30, 15P45 into 2A60. Putting the values from table, substituting it, you might be getting EPV square as this. Again, just one thing which I'll like to reiterate in this video is that some of the solutions might be numerically incorrect. We didn't really get much time. I didn't actually have time. I was wasn't well, so I have completed the solutions for this in an extremely short time. So there might be certain inconsistencies with these answers. So please feel absolutely free to inform us about this through the comments section of the video so that we can make changes to it and give a correct solution to students in case of any errors. Now to find VP variance of present value, you put the values and it comes out to be 5372.088 whole square. Question 7, 10 marks, pretty much I would say standard question which comes from chapter 19 to 21, it's pretty straightforward. So without wasting time directly, going to the solution. The thing you need to keep in mind to construct the equation directly is, first of all, when a bonus is vesting. Here it's a compound rate of bonus, it's vesting at the end of the year. So in denominator, I'll have this 1.0192308. And we have 6%, 1.923%. This is like the best combination which we could get because we know the resulting rate is nothing but 4%. So we get this 4% here. And then as for the maturity benefit, so you will have 150,000. Then you'll have another 20 years of bonus as well, right? And then you'll have discounting factor and probability. Now the part is, V to the power, V at the rate 6%. And 1.01923, these two combine to give us another V, which is effectively at 4%. So I have skipped a step here and directly written as 150,000 D65 by D select 45, where here D is nothing but being computed in the form of 4%. Plus 140 A45 20 at the rate 6%. So it's always a best practice that whenever you have multiple interest rates being used in an equation, you explicitly write that so that you do not forget it. You might, fall for this thing, I'll remember it. Okay, let's, not write it. Why waste time on this? But the point is, if you make a mistake, or maybe if you get the time to revise and you're coming back to a question, you might not remember which part was exactly 4% or 6%. You would again have to go to the question, flip it and, write it. So if you write it initially, it just ensures even if you're getting certain things wrong, you do not have to redo the work entirely. So it's one of the best practice. It might take time initially, but it's a foolproof way to carry out the work, given that if any errors are observed, those can be rectified at a pretty fast rate. Plus 200, plus 0.725p, plus 0.025p, ADU 45.20, at the rate 6% is p ADU 45.20, at the rate 6%. Calculations can be seen, the premium comes out to be 6493.03. So initially, as you see, there's an overwriting. I had missed this particular term of 200. So I was getting the benefits at 70,352 instead of 552. And I was obviously getting a wrong premium. So again, these are, common errors which might happen. So that is why, CM1 revolves around, practicing a lot. The more you practice, the more you're able to identify what sort of mistakes you are prone to make, and then you can work towards improving them and taking corrective measures for same. Next, question number 8. So it's a, looks like a long question. It's based on loan schedule. It's an 18 mark question. So we have a 10-year bank loan of $15,000. We have monthly payments and these are on the form of increasing. First payment being X, then 2X, then 60X. So for the first 5 years, it increases. And then the for the remaining 5 years, it remains out to be 60X. The worst part about this question is they have given an interest rate of 12% per annum effective. Had this been nominal rate of 12% per annum convertible monthly, we would have got an equivalent effectively monthly rate of 1%, which would have really simplified our calculations since we could have used actuarial tables to perform the same, but here that is not the case. So here it would have taken some amount of time to, you know, compute these. So all these parts, you can just take a look at the solutions. First, we find the monthly effective rate, and then we threw out the question we're working in months. 15,000 x IA 60 plus V to the power 60 into 60 x into A 60, working in months. A 60, we compute the value, IA 60, then we compute the value. It's always good that step by step, you put the values, you write it down separately so that later, if there is any error in one part, you do not have to redo the part again and again. If you are correct, you might feel ki, haan, okay, I didn't show the steps, I got it right. But the fact is ki, more often than not, all of us, even if I'm solving a paper, I might get a certain solution wrong. So it's always the best practice that whatever different actuarial functions like AN, IN, whatever are these, you separately calculate this and put down the value so that next time when you're trying to correct it, you know ki, which particular part needs to be corrected and do not have to redo the entire calculation. Solving this up to two decimal places, x comes out to be, you know, 5.33. Part three, we need to find the reserve at the end of 5 years using retrospective method. By applying the direct formula, the answer comes out to be 14,580.9. This is basically part four. Part three was basically expression. Part five is, you know, comment on an answer to part four. So you will see a loan of 15,000 has been taken even after 5 years, which is probably half of the term of the 10-year loan. The loan pending is still around 14,580. So still, you know, there was substantial, there hasn't been much reduction. The reason for this is that it's an increase. The loan is initially at a lower rate and keeps on increasing. So initially, whatever installments are paying is not even sufficient to cover the interest component of the loan. So what happens is in the initial term, the loan outstanding actually increases to more than 15,000. And later when the installment starts to increase, then subsequently the loan outstanding starts decreasing. So again, these type of questions, although on the day of the exam, it's pretty practical that you skip them if you're not sure about it. But when it comes to preparing for next session, this is how you should keep prepare. Identify what is happening. And this only happens if you observe while you're practicing questions. This is not something you'll get in 2 weeks or 3 weeks time by just, you know, looking at comments part separately. It is more to do with your theoretical understanding as well of what is happening, as well as your observation power. Ki what exactly is there given in the question, what is so different about it, how things work on it, and so on. It's extremely important for, you know, higher papers. I keep reiterating to all students, especially for those who intend to become a fellow actuary, that you need to develop this particular skill where you're able to analyze a particular question, see what words they have given, how to play around with them, how to infer them, and so on. Requires a lot of practice, but more importantly, it also requires you to observe things and keep in mind ki how things are working differently under different circumstances. Part six was write down an equation to calculate the total interest paid during 2027. So there's a technique for it wherein we find the loan outstanding on 31st December 26, then 31st December 27. The difference of this gives us the total amount of capital which has been repaid. And to get the total interest, what we can do is the total amount of installment which has been paid for that particular year minus the total capital portion being repaid during those particular year. So the answer comes out to be 1542.73. The last part is the bank also offers a 10-year loan with the same interest rate, but where the monthly installments remain level throughout the term. Comment on whether the total interest paid by the student under the revised offer would be greater or less than that paid under original repayment schedule. You should not perform any further calculations. So first of all, I'll give you one hack is for these questions, if you have time, which generally students do not have, but just in case you have time, maybe you can take an help of an Excel template if you already have that, you know, created for this question, or any other way you could maybe calculate and see what exactly is happening. So you know how to comment, whether it's increasing, whether it's decreasing. That is just one exam hack, not something to do during preparation. For that, you should know the underlying theory. So here the underlying theory is, if you're paying equal amounts throughout the term. So initially you're not paying low, you're paying the same amount throughout the term. Under the original schedule, you were paying less initially and more later. Here you're paying same throughout. So what happens here is that you're repaying the capital at a faster rate, so you will end up paying a less amount of interest. So it will be less since capital repaid would be faster, since we are giving higher installment amount right from the outset, and so loan outstanding would decrease faster, resulting in lower interest outgo. Again, you could maybe do it mathematically to get convinced ki yeah, this is the right way to be done. Next, question number 9, we have been asked to compute the initial annual rent payable by company A so that an internal rate of return of 9% is achieved. And part 2 is to show that, to demonstrate that the IRR of proposal B is more than 9%. So whenever we are asked to show that the IRR is more than, let's say, X percent, the simplest way to do is maybe you take X percent, you compute the NPV, and you will see that it's a positive value, which means that the internal rate of return for that project is more than the X percent. So for question 9, the thing to note is ki the rents are increasing at the rate of 3% compound per annum. And it's paid in actually in advance. So first one is X, second is X into 1.03, so on. The 20th rent will be paid at the beginning of the 20th year, which is nothing but time 19. So this is what we have. On solving, we get basically X to be nothing but 30,027. For part 2, what we have is NPV is 44,810.12 plus 66,010.12 minus 4 lakh. Evaluating at 9%, we get NPV to be roughly 90,081, and which is positive. So IRR, is actually greater than 9%. Next, what we have is loan has been taken out 9.5% per annum effective. The loan is to be repaid over 20 years in level installments payable annually in arrears. The green investment company decides to accept the proposal from company B and takes out a loan in order to purchase the factory. Calculate the accumulated profit of the investment after 20 years using an effective rate of interest of 9.5% per annum. So your accumulated profit becomes basically the 4 lakh rupees loan which you have taken today. Compounded to 1.095 to the power 20, you're accumulating it till time 20, and the cash flows which you're receiving, you find maybe the present value of it, multiply by the 20 years accumulation factor. On solving, you will be getting the answer of 4,44,300.2108. So roughly 4,44,300, correct up to unit digits. The last question number 10, it was a mortality profit question, 20 marks. Although part 2 was of 10 marks, but again, what it took me pretty less time actually to solve this question compared to others. So I assume that would have been the case with quite a few of you. So just to take you through what they've asked is to find P and S, where P is the premium, S is the sum assured, and what they've written is that the annual payments, the annual annuity payments were calculated to be exactly sufficient to pay the premiums for the endowment assurance as they fell due. So when we are purchasing a 15-year temporary life annuity of 50,000 rupees from a single premium, we can calculate the annuity amount, and this exactly annuity amount is the premiums which is being paid, to buy this 15-year without profit endowment assurance. So what exactly actually is happening in this product is that you're paying 50,000 rupees and ultimately you're getting an endowment assurance product, right? Because you're maybe paying 50,000, you're getting an annuity, you use the proceeds of that annuity to pay premiums every year. So there's a net off happening, basically the amount of money which you get at the end of the year, you're using that to pay at the beginning of the next year itself in the form of premiums. So effectively you're paying 50,000 rupees today to buy a without profit endowment assurance. So to find basically P, we need to find the value of the annuity. So here's the working for same. Let X be the annual annuity payments. 50,000 becomes X A due 4515. And X is nothing but 4391.357808 up till 2 decimal places comes out to be 36. So from question, the premium payment is nothing but this particular amount. Once we have this amount, we need to find S. Putting down the equation, calculating, we get it to be 88,846. For the second part, On 31st December 2020, there were 550 policies still in force, and during 2020, there were 6 deaths with no other decrements taking place. That is, on 1st January 2020, there were 556 policies in force. Remember the capital N which we are going to multiply while computing DSAR, or rather mortality profit, is nothing but the policy, number of policies in force at the beginning of the year of interest. So it's not 550, it is 556. This might be again one of the common mistakes which a lot of students might have, you know, performed. Instead of taking N as 556, they would have taken it to be 550. So capital N is 556, small n is 6, DSAR is nothing but 1.04 to the power 0.5, since the death benefit is payable immediately on death, minus 10V. We compute 10V, we get DSAR roughly to be 38,013, and then the mortality profit is nothing but 38,030, the DSAR minus expected number of deaths minus actual deaths. Excuse me, so we get a loss of roughly minus 1,44,043. Again, in this question, what they have written is the policies were actually issued with S equal to 90,000 payable under each endowment assurance policy and an annual premium P4450. Okay, so on. So part two, we see that mortality profit is negative. We need to make comments on it. So two things are there. One is the component of DSAR. Another is the difference between the expected and the actual deaths. Here DSAR is positive. So this will lead to a result in a negative mortality profit if the actual number of deaths is more than the expected number of deaths. So that is what we need to basically comment over here. So this was about the CM1 paper. As for, you know, if you want just some estimate regarding, you know, my opinion on what should be, what could be the passing marks, should be broadly in the range of 57 to 60. It was a lengthy paper. One or two different type of questions might have come, but overall it was an easier paper compared to, you know, previous sittings, or maybe the difficulty of paper level was similar to those, you know, in the previous terms. Nothing very difficult about this particular paper. So hope that you all found this video pretty useful. Do not forget to like this video and, you know, subscribe to our YouTube channel. And please, if you find any discrepancy, any errors in our solution, do let us know through comment section so that whenever we get time, we can, you know, correct these. Thank you. Bye.